So, good morning everybody, and welcome back to your second guest lecture. So, in the previous one we basically spoke about what are strengths and how to identify them. Now we're going to show you how to make some money out of it in a specific type of intervention. So, I'm going to show you one of the techniques that we've developed called the Talent Development Center. It's a strengths-based approach towards individual and organizational development. And I'm going to take you step by step through an example of one. And hopefully by the end of this, you'll be able to, you know, utilize strengths to make some actual money. And not just listen to these fluffy little ideas that we have in our heads in science. So we'll be talking about strengths-based development here and how do we utilize strengths to develop leadership. I think it's very important to remember that we develop people within roles, especially within companies. So it's important that we have somewhat of a framework that we can kind of like assess and the development, assess and develop people against. So the Strengths-Based Talent Development Center. So the whole thing was developed by a guy called Erik Stander, also a very good friend of mine. And he basically defined this strengths-based capability thing as a hybrid strengths-based capability assessment and development intervention that is really aimed at developing leadership's capability in order to ensure that leaders have the right capability in place, in order to also ensure that if a person leaves, that there is two or three other people that can kind of like take over. A specific function is threefold. One, it assesses and develops individuals' capabilities. Two, it provides real-time talent analytics aligned to the organization's strategy and talent management approach. And finally, it helps with talent mapping, career planning, and pathing and succession management. So the idea basically behind it is it's a technique that we utilize to to help identify leaders' strengths and capabilities, right? So that we can help them to become better leaders, so that we can also help other people to prepare themselves for that next level of leadership, and to have real-time data available for companies and managers to know that if we require a certain skill and capability, that we know who has it and how to utilize it. Finally, it also helps us to plan people's individual career paths on the one end, and it also helps us to ensure that we have a very good succession management plan in place. Okay, so the process is pretty straightforward. So on a high level, it basically involves six steps. We first clarify expectations and establish rapport with our clients and our executives. Then we develop our strengths-based capability matrix. From this, we then assess people, leaders, against this capability matrix in various ways, psychometrics, simulations, interviews. Based on the combination of these two things, we provide them with feedback on what we saw. We then help them to set up a individual development plan, and we then coach them through this entire process. And then if there is a need, we repeat. So this is basically the overall process. We clarify expectations with our client as well as his manager and his direct manager, and we establish rapport with our client because the relationship is the most important function that predicts success in this process. We develop a capability matrix that is aligned to this to the overall business strategy, but also to each role. We assess people based on the next level of leadership. So if you think president, vice president, we will assess a vice president against the capabilities of a president. Why? Because if you're a vice president, you should be functioning well in your position, and we want to help you to grow. We provide you with feedback. With this all in place, we help you set a plan in place, and then we coach you. Okay, that's the overall process. In practice, this is kind of like the process that we take. So after we've gotten the instruction, it's really important to send out a letter from the CEO or someone in a very senior position to kind of introduce the program, but also to orientate people to the process. Why? Because if it looks like leaders, management supports it, then people are also a lot more inclined to take it seriously. So we engage people by sending a nice introduction letter saying like, welcome, you've been selected as one of the most important leaders in our company, we really want to invest in your development, this is how this process is going to go. So after that, we give about 1 or 2 weeks for what we call pre-work. Here we send them an invitation with instructions on how to complete a whole bunch of psychometric assessments. That's the VIA strengths inventory. That's depending on whatever the capabilities are that we are assessing, but we send them a link with electronic questionnaires for them to complete. Then we invite them for an on-site, or in this case also virtual talent development center, and this is basically 1 or 2 days where we take people through active simulations, assessments, all structured around what we call phenomenon-based learning principles. So here the idea is that you basically learn as you are growing through each simulation and applying the learnings from the previous phase in the next. So after this intensive process, we also give them feedback, of course, and we help them at least initially to kind of identify the goals that's important for them. Then afterwards, we clarify expectations between the different stakeholders. So we clarify expectations between our client and his manager, to kind of really say, what do you expect of me, what do I expect of you, and what do we expect from this role? We also give them one-on-one feedback then, where we tell them exactly what we saw and talk them through this, their strengths and their capabilities, and also to get an idea of where they see themselves in the future. Based on this, we then help them set a personal development plan in place to really ensure that their development process is tracked and on place and on par, so that they know exactly what their strengths are and where they are going. After that, we have a call with line managers and HR, not talking about the individual, but talking about the overall capabilities that's in place, to kind of show them what skills and capabilities and strengths do they have available if they need it. And then we coach them for a period of 3 to 6 months. So in terms of the first phase, clarifying expectations, it's really important to understand what the organization's growth goals and strategic imperatives are. It's important because if you have to develop a person based on the requirements of the company, if a company doesn't need, if you're not client-facing whatsoever, why would you want to train client-facing behaviors, for example? So it's really important to ensure that you understand what the business environment is about, and this is the fundamental principle of the TDC. You have to understand also what are their KPIs, both on individual and on the organization's level, what's their overall business strategy, and how do all of these different systems, internally and externally, kind of like fit together. So how does production affect marketing, and how does marketing affect sales, and how does sales affect their global positioning, for example. So you have to understand how all of these different functions in the company fits together. An HR person or a people development person is not just focusing on the people. They have to understand the business strategy. The next part is we also have to have some other formal contract in place that captures the expectations that you have and that they have from the process, but also to ensure that these expectations are aligned to each stakeholder, so between managers and employees and between management and leaders and so on. We can get to know the company and the coachee's environment by looking at their performance appraisals, by job shadowing them, by having discussions. So the whole job profiling thing comes very important here. So you have to understand the candidate's entire environment within this larger system. So based on all of this information, we then co-construct a broader understanding of this a coachee's or a leader's capabilities or what he requires to function effectively in this specific role. So based on this, we then set up what we call a positive capability matrix. And we know that performance, right? So that growth is a function of two things, individual performance and a person's potential. So on an individual performance perspective, we really focus on the specific competencies required for that job. So based on the previous phase, we identify the specific competencies that's important for that specific role. So for example, strategic visioning, talent development, or managing change, for example, these are competencies that's important for them, and we figure out ways to assess it. We know that past experience predicts future experience, past performance predicts future performance. So we really know, we look at here, for example, leaders' accomplishments, right? How they relate to others, how fast their career progress. So these things give us an indication also of how likely they are to perform. On the potential side, this is the side where we can kind of like develop. We look at a person's actual ability. So think learning potential here. Learning potential is a function of verbal reasoning, abstract reasoning, problem solving. It's your traditional intelligence components. And finally, it is values. And this is not the person's values, this is the company values. So a company has certain things that's important for them, and we also assess the client, the candidate for that matter, against the values of the company. Because the higher the level of alignment between the two, the more likely this person will be to fit in, the more likely they are then to perform. Okay, does this make sense? And all of this stuff is always strengths focused. So it's really focused on the positive orientated aspects of the people. So we don't want to fix things that are wrong. We want to optimize. Okay, very important here. So how do we then get this information? We get this information through a couple of stuff. We get it through psychometrics, strength spotting, of course, listening for their strengths while interviewing them. We generate very what we call fit for purpose simulations. So we design simulations and activities that are really centered around the things we want to assess. So for example, if we want to assess talent development, for example, we can design some other role play where a person comes up with where I'm a client and you're my coach or my manager, and I come to you and I say, oh, I'm having troubles with my team, help me. Right, so we develop a very structured simulation to assess these capabilities, right? And of course, we also have a strengths-based interviewing. So then we go about and we give individual feedback, and there's a process. So we give individual dashboards that kind of look like this, right, for the client, so they know in terms of each of these areas, competence, experience, abilities, and values, where they rate in relation to others. So we have, we benchmark, we norm, because it's important, so that people kind of like know what is their level in relation to what the role expects. We also give a nice summary of the areas of that they feel that they need to develop in, and etc. So just to summarize the overall results. Then we use psychometric results, so we give feedback on psychometrics. And from this, we kind of like identify like their strengths and their developmental areas. So the things they're really good at and the things that they're not so good at. We also then, based on these information that we got, we come up with a what we call a capability map. So then we know exactly what their propensity to perform is, how likely they are to go on to the next level, these types of things. So we basically rate them on this capability matrix. Then we give them feedback on it. So we give them strengths-based feedback. So we really take a strengths-based approach, talking about their competence from this perspective, highlighting how they're utilizing their strengths to be able to function effectively. So based on all four of these aspects, we then develop a what we call a IDP, an individual development plan, or a personal development plan, which basically summarizes where they want to go in their lives or in their careers, where they are now, and figuring out the steps in order to be able to get there, and figuring out how can we utilize their strengths and their capabilities to be able to help them to get there. Finally, we also figure out a way to actively track these things. So we help them to construct a way to track goal progression, but also well-being. So the next phase then is we develop this individual development plan. So again, we merge all of the data from all of the different phases. We help to identify their current needs. So in other words, the things that they really want to achieve, the things that they are really passionate about, also their needs from a developmental perspective, things they want to become better at. And as you listen to this, you start to pick up what we call coaching themes. So the same issue, or the same need, will kind of like manifest in different aspects. And it's your job as the coach to kind of listen very carefully to understand what the primary goals are, right? The primary coaching themes are. From this, we also help them to identify both internal and external resources. So what environmental resources do they have that can help them to achieve their goals? and also making sure that every goal that we have in place is actually aligned to their interests. From this perspective, we also help them to develop what we call a strengths-based mindset. So the idea here is to say that any function of performance is always an outcome of some other form of strengths use. So they need to become aware of what their strengths are and become conscious of when they're actually utilizing these strengths. And when an issue is arriving, so that they also know that if an issue is there, I can use a certain strength to help me to address this specific problem. We also help them to identify life challenges. So for example, now with the whole COVID thing, work-home integration stuff, things that they might be struggling with, and help them to figure out ways to manage that. We break this all of this stuff then down into very smart goals, so specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, time-bound goals, so that we also set very clear expectations in relation to the next 6 months of our coaching process. And all of this then culminates in a personal development plan. So what do you need to make this thing basically work? So the first thing is, you have your SMART goal, for example, in the middle. Let's say I want to lose weight, right? We have to figure out, firstly, having a very clear path on how am I going to be able to lose weight? What does lost weight look like? Maybe I want to lose 20 kilograms before September next year, right? So then I have to put up a very clear path on what do I need to have in place to be able to get there. Maybe I need to start eating better, going to the gym 3 times a week, you know, these types of things. I have a very clear career path. The thing here is that even though I have this path in place, I need to ensure that we focus on the right things first. So I can't just, maybe I say I want to run a mile then. I can't just go out and automatically start running a mile full speed. I have to focus on the fundamental things first. Maybe I need to train a little bit better. Maybe I need to eat a little bit better. So focus on the right tasks first. And then from this, we isolate what we call the key moves, the things that are most important, things I most struggle with, and really focus on doing this stuff over and over and over, what you call meaningful repetition, so that a person can learn from their mistakes, so that they can grow. Think about a concert pianist, for example. These people usually make a mistake with some specific type of move or note or progression or whatever you call it, and then they will play this over and over and over, but not just playing it over, but really playing it and figuring out where their mistakes are, isolating the mistakes and figuring out ways to fix it, and then trying again. Then you also have to find get active feedback and also reflection. This is where the coach then comes in. But you also have to reflect on how is this goal achieving process affecting you? Is it actually what you want to do? Did you have the unrealistic expectations? But the most important thing here with all of this stuff in place is find your cheerleaders, your supporters, and your mentors. Because these are the people that will encourage you to get to your goals. And you, of course, act as a coach here in this process where you can actually facilitate this process, but the client needs to find the cheerleaders, the people that will, they're rah-rah girls, the people that will motivate them to go on, even though their ideas are super stupid, and mentors that can help them to push through these difficult scenarios. So, and here is an example then of what a IDP would look like. We would give a person some feedback on what their strengths are, so here, appreciation of beauty, leadership, creativity, and their areas of development. Based on this, we break down each one of those domains, competence, blah, blah, blah. And we say, maybe what's important for this person needs to develop cross-cultural intelligence, right? What is the area? How does he need to do this? He needs to identify and contract a mentor of a host country and being mentored by them. And this will be done by the first quarter in 2018. Why this specific action tracker? Because this person has, for example, very good creativity and leadership and appreciation of beauty. And I remember this one specifically, very good at establishing relationships. So utilizing those strengths is where this developmental action comes in. With the IDP in place, we then basically coach them actively through this process from a strengths-based perspective. So on an individual level, we establish a relationship, we assess their strengths that we have now, we help them to develop a clear plan, we set their goals, we coach them through, we empower them, we give them homework, and we track it effectively. In another video, in the next video, I'll go into a lot more detail on this coaching model. So with that said, I really hope that I learned you a little bit something, and actively how you can make some money out of this whole strengths-based thing. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your time.